We'll begin with Professor Annalisa Caputo's paper, which is entitled Paul Ricoeur, Martha Nussbaum, and the Incapability Approach. Professor Caputo is a professor at the University of Bari in Italy, and she teaches in the area of languages of philosophy. And we're in here because she'll be projecting her paper up for your pleasure to read. We'll turn it over to Professor Caputo.
Thank you very much. I'd like really to thank the organizer for inviting me. This presentation is the result of an observation. Despite the differences in perspective, Paul Ricoeur and Martha Nussbaum have both taken an interest in human vulnerability. And within this topic, in a move unusual for philosophers, each of them has dedicated interesting pages to the issue of mental disability. Considered not so much as a social or educational problem, but as the litmus test of their philosophical theories. This because, we can say in advance, the experience of disability forces us to focus not only on what each man can, homo capax, but also on what he cannot, homo incapax. And if the capability approach is fundamental regarding the ethical and political implication that it can generate, the approach to incapability, or incapability approach, as we will try to demonstrate, is to offer scenarios that are new to the crucial question, who am I? I will respond to this question conclusively, articulating my presentation in three steps. After a brief introduction, in which I will refer some key passages of the dialogue between Ricoeur and Nussbaum, in the first part, I will try to provide the key elements of Nussbaum's anthropology in relation to the theory of human capability and incapability. In the second part, I will highlight some limitations of the position of the American philosopher, in particular where Nussbaum discusses the incapability of the mentally disabled. In the last part, I will focus on Ricoeur's essay, The Difference Between the Normal and the Pathological as a Source of Respect, showing how he is able to overcome the risks of Nussbaum's position, thanks to his spatial recognition theory, a theory also applicable of human suffering and mental disability. Therefore, in conclusion, I will ask if this perspective forces us to change not only the way how we so-called normal people look at the people with disabilities, but also, and above all, how we look at ourselves. So, introduction. Is Ricoeur really in conversation with ethical thought in the Anglo-American tradition? In 2003, in an interview for Ethics and Economics, Nussbaum claimed not to know the books of Ricoeur in depth, with the exception of the theory of tragedy, on which she wrote a little paper in a volume edited by John Wall. This paper, entitled Ricoeur on Tragedy, was published in 2002. And was, in a certain sense, a response to the interpretation of tragedy made by Ricoeur in Oneself as Another. In this book, Ricoeur had mentioned Nussbaum several times, calling her a fine Hellenist and philosopher, and stressing the importance of her book, The Fragility of Goodness, with regard to the theme of human suffering and fragile man. Nussbaum's essay is, therefore, a response to Ricoeur's counter-interpretation. Various affinities regarding the Aristotelian idea of ethics and the issue of practical wisdom, to phronein, emerge from pages of the two philosophers, but by reading between the lines, their differences also emerge. This was evidently a difference of perspectives that Nussbaum must have considered even greater than her essay Letton, if in the interview the philosopher could concisely claim, although the lamentable division between continental philosophy and analytic philosophy has lessened in recent years, I fear that Ricoeur is still not really in conversation with the ethical thought in the Anglo-American tradition. It was a strong statement, which could ever blocked any research into the similarities between the two thinkers. However, it didn't work out that way. Consider the studies that emphasize the affinities regarding the narrative, imaginative, aesthetic, or regarding ethical, emotional issues. But above all, consider the phenomenologie de l'homme capable, through which Ricoeur, in Percours de la Reconnaissance, engages in an intense dialogue with the capability approach, although without directly quoting Nussbaum. A number of scholars have written on these issues, see in particular the volume Transforming Unjust. And so all this alone, would be enough to call into question the possibility of a conversation between Ricoeur and Nussbaum, Ricoeur and the ethical Anglo-American tradition. However, my proposal, as mentioned, is not to reconstruct the already well-known story of this posthumous dialogue, but to focus on another subject, little studied by critics, the theme of the incapability approach. And let's start with Martha Nussbaum. Are we all able to flourish? As we know, Frontiers of Justice arose from an intense confrontation with Rawls's theory, a theory which, according to Nussbaum, is unable to account for three important problem areas: justice to non-human animals, justice across national boundaries, and, what interests us here, the relationship between contractualism and disability. Rawls builds his theory of justice through the artifice of the original position linked to the veil of ignorance. Now, according to Nussbaum, the problem lies not so much in Rawls' hypothesis, according to which in the original position the choice would inevitably orient toward criteria of fairness and impartiality, but in the original position itself. The crux of the matter, in fact, before being ethical, is anthropological, because individuals are not equal. To say that we are approximately free, equal, and independent already means, in truth, to recognize that we are very different from each other for biological, social, and intellectual reasons. Some individuals are less equal than others, so much so as not to be able to be part of the original Rawlsian position. People with disabilities, for example, in particular those with a mental disability, would not be able to participate as subjects of justice in the game of the contract imagined by Rawls. Lacking conceptual rationality and autonomy, they may participate only as objects of charity and compassion. So the procedural approach fails here, not only in practice, but it also demonstrates its theoretical unsustainability. This is where Nussbaum proposal, the capability approach, comes in. An approach whereby a human life is worth living not for the rationality or autonomy that characterize it, but for the flourishing that it's capable of manifesting. The basic principles of this fair and good life are given by the minimum threshold of a set of capability that every human person can have. Life, bodily health and integrity, senses, imagination, thought, emotions, practical reason, affiliation, relationships with other species, play, and control over our environment. This theoretical scenario, although widely shared, presents, however, some problematic aspects regarding both the choice of the list of capabilities and the definition of threshold of capability. Problematic aspects that are also reflected as a consequence in Nussbaum's anthropological vision. Who decides I deserve to live? Negating and reversing human's law, Nussbaum derives an is from an ought. Therefore, this leads her not only to wonder quite rightly what are the obstacles to be overcome so that everyone can practice their abilities up to the appropriate threshold level, but it also leads her, wrongly, to select some real characteristic of a typical form of human life that seem normatively fundamental, and to say that a life without any possibility at all of exercising one of them at any level is not a fully human life, a life worthy of human dignity, even if the others are present. Beyond the nuances and the examples put forward by Nussbaum, specific cases which I don't want to go into, what is not convincing, in my opinion, is the link between capability, minimum threshold, life worth living, and human person. As Nussbaum herself argues, in fact, her thesis is intuitive and discursive. Because the list of capabilities is plural and open-ended, so only a rational procedural discussion, which allows the subjects involved to share the list regardless of social, metaphysical, religious perspective, can widen and aspire to universalizing the list of the fundamental capabilities. But those who decide what is human and which life is worth being lived are, and will always and only be, those who have rational argumentative capabilities. If this is so, Nussbaum remains in the wake of Rawls and doesn't exceed his teacher. To pursue the defense of the right of some people with a mental handicap who have some obvious, evident capabilities, Nussbaum forgets that the majority of people with mental disabilities have capabilities that are not obvious, evident, and may not be included in a list. Think of the still wide open field of research on autistic children with severe mental retardation. Nussbaum writes, some types of mental deprivation are so acute that it seems sensible to say that life of these anencephalic children, for example, is simply not a human life at all. But we ask, why some disabled children used as examples by Nussbaum are not types belonging to a lower kind, while in other cases we are witnessing a different form of life and therefore not worthy of being lived? Is not Nussbaum herself who admits that the capabilities approach seems to attach some significance to species membership as such, because a child lives as a member of the human community and not of another community, and it is within his community that he will flourish or not flourish? This is neither an intuitive criterion nor metaphysical nor religious. It is a biological social criterion linked to the community dimension in which and from which the individual is born. Human life is not tied to a list of capabilities but to a set of relationships. Community relationships, therefore, should be foundational with respect to establishment of a list of human capabilities and inhuman incapabilities. And that's what Ricoeur does, showing how the human individual is first and foremost a son, a daughter, showing how each of us exists only as the result of a gift, as an inestimable object of transmission, showing how the self is the result of an overabundant lineage of love, is the gift of the transmission of life, given by parents, indicated on the family tree, rooted in the history of our ancestors. This is the mystery of the birth and parentage. Only by starting from this point we can decide who deserves to love, to live. And as we know, this is the ethical ontological scenario of Ricoeur's last texts. Setting ourselves then in this framework, let us look more closely, conclusively, at how Ricoeur interprets the presence of people with mental disabilities in relation to others and to the world. The difference between the normal and the pathological is a source of respect. This is the title of a lecture given by Ricoeur in 1997 at the ARCH Association. The title alone show us how Ricoeur's perspective differs radically from that of Nussbaum, because for her the pathological can never be structurally worthy in itself of respect and attention. Instead, Ricoeur believes that it is possible to articulate a certain idea of respect. And he carries forward this articulation by invalidating the juxtaposition which we usually accept: normal, pathological, healthy, disabled, and we may add intelligent, delayed. Starting from the biological and not from the intuitive, and following the reflections of Canguilhem, Ricoeur traces three interrelated circles: the pathological on the biological level, on the social level, and at the existential level. Like all living beings, man is bios, and exactly for this reason can live in irregularity, deviation, abnormality. The physical order cannot be broken. An apple detached from the tree cannot not fall to the ground. The biological order, instead, is characterized precisely by its precariousness. Even health is no more than a limited capacity to deal with threats and dysfunction, including handicaps. Zurcher criticizes what he calls an insolent aspect of health. However, we as fragile and wounded beings fear this shuffling of cards, because it might bring us to our senses the feeling of incertitude that goes with our mortality. Suffering and disability are a silent menace, a disturbing reminder of our fragility, our precariousness. And therefore, an individual and social removal mechanism springs into action against those who embody this memento mori. This is the social level of pathology. Regarding this aspect, Ricoeur puts together the masters of suspicion and Foucault's decisive analysis on the bird of internment and hospitals. Here, disease is no longer seen as a normal threat, the normal failure which is inevitable soon or later in life, but it is seen as abnormality, where the norm, the normal, become the capable, rational, self-sufficient subject. It is not only a coincidence, Foucault has taught us, that the movement pushing for the internment of those who are different coincides in modern times with the growth of the Cartesian idea of man as a self-centered cogito. The psychiatric hospital and the prison for the collective imagination are not part of the city. Symbolically, they exist outside the city wall, Ricoeur points out. Disability is not just a boundary, but an outside with respect to the modern conception of anthropology and ethics. And a mentally disabled person is in a situation twice as difficult. He is, par excellence, inhuman, a subman, a non-man. Hence, he is socially ratified in his inferiority and depreciation. But in doing so, Ricoeur points out, the so-called normal people are unconsciously and dramatically consolidated in their idea of being man because they are rational, responsible, autonomous. And the more we charge the individual, solitary subject with responsibilities, the more this burden becomes unbearable for everyone. And mind you, this applies to everyone, and not just to people with disabilities, because in this process of the creation of lines of exclusions, no one is excluded. The other, the sick, the disabled, the insane, the sufferer, writes Ricoeur with a very dense and very beautiful expression, is my infinitely close double. We are thus in the innermost, most intimate circle, the existential level of the pathological. Yes, because even assuming that I perceive myself as normal from the biological point of view, and I'm perceived as normal by others from the social point of view, inside myself the question remains. Am I happy? Am I flourishing, to use Nussbaum's terminology? Am I developing my skills in an existential project that really brings to fulfillment what I am and what I want? This is the question of personal identity, which, as Ricoeur has taught us, is never an idem, but is always the object of an indefinite, interminable quest. and the sorrows, injuries, blows to our self-esteem, broken relationships, our small and large melancholies, constantly threaten our capability to weave a sense of ourself. And we know what a heavy burden this all is, this threat inscribed in each of us, once we begin to consent to sadness, to fatigue, to discouragement. So we can easily imagine how destructive this threat can become for those who live with a mental suffering or a mental disability. This esteem is rooted in biological reason, it is fed by social pseudo-reason, and is rampant in existential dynamics, building in the subjects in question on the subconscious level, even before the conscious level, the image of a failed self, and not only fallible, unsuccessful self, and not just only vulnerable. It is a denial of dignity, a denial of recognition, writes Ricoeur. And this is where Ricoeur's proposal, the recognition theory, comes in. In fact, for Ricoeur, each of us is an aiming at a good life with and for others in just institutions. And for this eudaimonia, both self-esteem and the approval that others give to the self are necessary. It is in this mutuality that the fundamental relationships, family, friends, society, that allow each of us to feel appreciated, loved, and therefore worthy of existing, are structured. This means that we are not self-centered, independent, highly capable subjects, but vulnerable people who exist thanks to and as part of an interwinding of fragile relationships. Relationships that help us endure insecurity and build our stories. This anthropology, radically different from that of Nussbaum, allows us with Ricoeur to interpret a mental disability in a different way. A mentally disabled people is not ontologically different from me. She is like me, fragility and narration, capability and incapability, filiation and appreciation. Being recognized is what put us in position to flourish. It is being adopted by our own parents, an act which Ricoeur reminds us the ancient Romans did in a solemn ceremony. It is being welcomed into the community of man, which makes us children of man, and therefore worthy of being human. This is true for a normal child, but also for a child who, in our eyes, has no capability. The eyes of someone who will be able to love him will make him a child, a son, a daughter, a person. Here, more than in other cases, Ricoeur points out, it will be necessary to compensate from the deficit in self-esteem and courage by supplementing esteem. This is what, according to Ricoeur, doctors are called upon to do, but we might add, the closest, are called upon to do. Of course, in the case of individuals with serious mental disabilities, there is and there will always be a radical asymmetry in comparison with the others, which will always make the relationship of reciprocity asymmetrical to some extent. Inevitably, it will always be others, family, friends, doctor, who decide for them. But doesn't this radical asymmetry characterize the most radical phases of our lives, those which, to use another of Ricoeur's expression, are close to the fundamental, birth, illness, agony. In these fundamental experiences, each of us has experienced and will experience the asymmetry of the dependence. At the same time, each of us has experienced and will experience that this is where the desire, and we hope the courage, to exist, to continue to be men, emerges. Men, despite the suffering, men, despite the asymmetry of dependency, men, despite our being in that situation, only incapable recipients and not capable agents. Only incapable recipients. Here, the final plot twist in Ricoeur's essay connects deeply this question to what, in my opinion, is one of the most original points in the philosophy of Ricoeur, the phenomenology of the gift. Recognition becomes gratitude. The human being is a given, a gift, called upon to give, to donate. Giving is not a gesture connected simply to a rational choice. It's the result of a flourishing, we could say, contaminating Ricoeur with Nussbaum. In fact, we receive only what we cultivate and render fruitful. The ante-predicative, the non-rational, is in itself a gift. The symbol gives rise to two. So, what precedes thought and precedes us as thinker, dona pensé, gives a gift to two. Paradoxically, then, a person with cognitive delays, a person who doesn't have a reflective cogito, dona pensé. And this means not only that the issue of the mental retardation gives a gift to philosophy, offering itself as a philosophical theme. But more fundamentally, it means a person incapable of cognitive rationality give a gift to those of us who think through cognitive rationality. He, she shows us a sense that precedes us and challenges us in the art of existence. Far from being a nonsense, the life of a being who has a conceptual disability in close proximity to the fundamental becomes the possible stimulus for radical questioning on the mystery of life and death. And here then is the conclusion that in the first aspect, related to the enhancement of capabilities, is quite comparable to that of Nussbaum. But to this, Ricoeur adds a second aspect, decidedly distant from Nussbaum's scenario. Because the ultimate goal of this discernment is not only that of improving coexistence, but it is a primarily discernment of the self, discernment of me. Discerning the resources of the person with a disability is, open to those who are well, to welcome this proposition regarding the meaning of illness and to allow it to aid them in bearing their own vulnerability, their own mortality. Those who live the limits of incapability intensely remind us of this meaning. We can remove this proposition, removing them from our horizon of being and thinking, or we can give them this gift, that of embracing in a paradoxical, asymmetrical reciprocity, the gift that they give to us, the gift of reminding us of our fragility. Mental disability dona pensé, and it reminds me that I am the other. Thanks.
Well, thank you, Professor Caputo, for that very engaging and excellent paper responding to Martha Nussbaum's idea of capability. I think we could say that Professor Caputo has shown us that Ricoeur actually does engage Anglo-American philosophy of ethics. And also thank you for the very arresting visual presentation to go along with it. Let's open up for a couple of questions. We have about 5 or 10 minutes before we turn to Jeffrey's paper.
Yes. It was very interesting. And I will tell you something that probably you don't know. Ricoeur had the experience of the daughter of Mounier. Mm-hmm. Mounier's first daughter, Françoise, when she was born, they gave her a vaccine, and the brain was disabled to a point that is not imaginable. Mm-hmm. She was a vegetarian, and Mounier has written wonderful things about his daughter, telling that she was a person. And that's very something that is in the back side of Ricoeur's experience. And he had other experience of vulnerability. His mother was died when he was born, the father in the war, and all the things that happened during his life. But the case of Françoise Mounier is very important. Mm-hmm. She was not able of any reciprocity, any. She could not talk anything. She was like, I don't know, I have not, never seen her.
Yes, I know.
I was not here.
I think that...
But it is very important to...
Yes.
And the words you have, I was very pleased when you have chosen very good phrases of Ricoeur, very meaningful.
Thank you very much. I didn't think about this relationship. But I think that Mounier gives more religious reason when he spoke about his daughter. The interesting thing of Ricoeur, in my opinion, is that he tries to give some philosophical reasons. Yes.
I haven't read Nussbaum's book, but I imagine her approach would be quite relevant to very fraught questions philosophically, such as the question of assisted suicide for terminally ill people, and probably also would be relevant to the abortion debate, the right to terminate pregnancy. So her approach has the merit that by putting certain limits on capability and the human life, it would actually provide some support for decisions of people who want to terminate their life in abortion cases. And Ricoeur, on the other hand, would seem not to allow that. And I can imagine that there would be deep, profound religious reasons why Ricoeur would never go in that direction. Also philosophical reasons that he touches upon in his book, Living After Death. But would it be interesting to bring in maybe Ricoeur's notion of autonomy? And then ultimately recognize that there is a very interesting tension there between the fragility of the being, but also the autonomy of the self. And that if you are granting autonomy, do you more or less have to also grant that the decision does belong, in some cases, with the individual self?
Yes, thank you very much. Of course, the purpose of my speech was only to underline some affinities and some differences between the two thinkers. This is where the bioethical, I think, no, question come in. And I didn't have time to speak, and it isn't also my field of research. But in any case, I think that for Ricoeur, we cannot give a generic response for the specific questions. No, only the pratic windows, phronesis, no, can evaluate individual cases, also in case of a mother, a child, autonomy, and so on. So I think that with Ricoeur we cannot have a response that we can universalize about the relationship between mother and child. Mm-hmm. But I will think about that.
But
thank you.
There is a point, a line of exclusion, which was never underlined by Ricoeur, was racial, mm-hmm. racial exclusion.
Mm-hmm. Yes, of course. Yes.
Other questions?
Thank you for your question. Very good discussion. I have only a simple question. The concept of Ricoeur of homo capens depends on Martin Simon Baum's thought or no?
I think that there is a relationship, of course, with Amartya Sen. In the course of recognition, he engaged with Sen thought. I don't think that it depends on Marta Nussbaum. He don't quote, and yes, I think the links is Amartya Sen, and of course for Ricoeur, Aristotle, Marx, also as Nussbaum. I think, but yeah, there are surely thinkers that can say better as me this response.
Any other questions? I think we'll invite Jeffrey up to the join us here at the table. Give a round of applause again to Annalisa.
Thank you.